just like my favorite song going round, round my head. You're listening to the Off the Huzzle podcast presented by Rollo Golf. Your hosts are Drew Koser, Troy Koser, Tori Coughlin, and Turner Ripplinger. Reminder, presented by Rollo Golf, TaylorMade affiliated. Now sit back and enjoy the podcast. All right, we're pleased to have on the podcast today from Vienna, Austria. Played college golf at the University of Georgia. Go Dogs. He is currently playing the PGA Tour and just finished up at the Tour Championship this past weekend. Lots to chat about here with Sepp. After all that, happy to have on today, Sepp Straka. Thanks for joining the podcast today, man.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
So, what's
Ryder Cup?
What's happening?
Not a whole lot. Taking a few days off before I start getting ready for the next event in Wentworth.
Wentworth, where's that?
Ooh, that's just outside of London.
Oh, sick.
Yeah, a DP Tour event. I'll play there in Madrid back-to-back weeks, and then I'll have a longer break after that.
Do you have status on DP?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Because you're on the Ryder Cup, or do you play a lot over there?
No, I play some. I definitely don't play a lot with the PGA schedule being as tight as it is, but I try to go over there a decent amount and play, especially now that the fall's a little more open for us. I try to go over there in the fall and play some.
Gotcha.
Okay, so I'm going to jump right in here quickly here. Loaded question. First off, how was this past week? Tour Championship. Obviously, we just talked about what's going on. And then I want to know how you know Tori, because Tori's a well-known man, obviously, on this podcast. So let's hear the details.
Yeah, Tour Championship is great. I mean, it's always awesome to be there a third year in a row, which is pretty special for me. Didn't play as well as I wanted to, especially on Sunday. But it was a great week. It was a lot of fun. I got to know Tori through Shoal Creek, basically just caddying out there.
So we normally go in chronological order, but like, stuttering. Since we're on the topic of tour championships, I'm sorry, Sepp. Like, how is the playoffs now, like, that it's a smaller field and there's more pressure to play well to keep advancing with just three events instead of four? And what do you start with, 70 instead of 125?
Yeah, 70 in the first event. It's definitely a lot different than it was, what, 3 or 4 years ago, not that long ago. It used to be kind of a long season starting in October, kind of, and then it wrapped around all the way to August, September to the playoffs. And I feel like now it's kind of turned into more of a sprint, because it used to be 125, now it's 70. And now you only have from January till August to get the points to get into the top 70 of the FedEx playoffs. So I feel like it's a lot more of a sprint than it used to be. You're just playing a lot of golf in those 6-7 months and trying to get into those playoffs. And then if you do play well, you get rewarded in the fall. You can get kind of take a little bit of time off. But those 6-7 months are definitely a little more crammed than they used to be.
Yeah, because when I talked to you, like, it was probably, what, 2 months ago, maybe 2.5 months ago. I wanted to get you on, but it was like every week you were playing. And then Drew was like, what about Sepp Straka? And it was like a couple of weeks ago, he's like, he's in the playoffs. Like, I'm not even going to text you while you're in that.
Dude, we should do a live interview while he's playing, like they do on the PGA Tours. Put a pod in and we're just interviewing him.
Yeah.
Like mid round.
Yeah. It was definitely pretty intense there for a while. I think from the beginning, end of April through till the first playoff event, I think I had maybe 3 or 4 weeks off. So it was a lot of golf, but fortunately I played some pretty good golf, so I got myself in the playoffs.
Attaboy.
Yeah, I want to ask here, Tori, I want to just jump in here and then I want to turn it going here, but I want to backtrack to when you were younger, growing up in Vienna, Austria. Obviously hobbies you're up to, was it golf 24/7, or were you playing like soccer? Like, what kind of sports were you up to in Austria?
Yeah, grew up, number one sport was soccer. Nice. I think everybody, especially around Vienna, soccer was always the number one sport. Played that till I was about 11 or 12. I played a little bit of baseball, a little bit of basketball too, but soccer was always number one until conditioning became an aspect. So I kind of decided I didn't want to run as much in practice. So yeah, my brother and I did a golf camp in the summer when we were like 11 years old, 11 or 12 years old, and just kind of got hooked. Yeah, we just loved it and started really practicing at that point.
In case you guys didn't know, Sepp is a brick shit house.
Really shredded, eh? In the gym lots or what?
Oh, he's a unit.
I don't know about shredded. I'm big, but most of that's fat, I would say.
I would not want to run into him on skates. I'll put it that way.
Well, speaking of on skates, Rip, you're up, big guy. If you got anything here, jump right in.
So after that golf camp, you were starting to play more and more. When did you realize that you were like, hey, I'm pretty good at golf?
Honestly, there's a lot of times where I still don't think I'm that good at golf, but this has a good way of humbling you, the sport does. But when I got recruited by Georgia and ended up going to Georgia, I knew that, that was a pretty special moment for me, because I knew there was just so many dogs out on the PGA Tour, and I knew that a lot of really, really good players had gone through there. So if they could do it, kind of, I had a pretty good chance of doing it myself. And yeah, that's kind of when the end of high school, beginning of college is kind of when things kind of started coming together a little bit.
Hey, so imagine Sepp Straka, just like those TikToks. My name's Sepp Straka. I'm going to University of Georgia. Go dog.
So tell people how you ended up in Georgia.
Yeah, my mom's from South Georgia. So dad's Austrian, mom's from South Georgia. So we moved when I was 14 to be closer to her family. And that's when kind of golf started really ramping up a little bit. We started playing a lot of junior tournaments over here, and started the whole recruiting process, which we had no idea what that was about growing up. So, that was a big point kind of in my brother's golf career, I guess. I've got a twin in case of that, and we kind of did the whole thing together.
Suck it, Dad. We're going to Georgia.
So like junior golf in Austria, was it junior golf and then amateur golf, or was it like kind of all just one thing over there?
We had a really good junior tour actually in Austria. It was all throughout Austria. They had, I don't know how many events, 12, 13 events. All the kind of the best juniors got together and played events, and with some really good competition, a bunch of guys that still play golf. And I think that was huge for us to kind of get our feet wet in competitive golf before we came over to the States. And it was awesome.
How many other schools did you go on visits for? Or was it just Georgia?
We went to Georgia Tech and Georgia Southern. I knew Georgia Tech pretty quickly was not going to be a fit for us. Just Atlanta, big city. We didn't really love that. Georgia Southern was actually pretty impressive. They've got a great practice facility there. But we were Georgia fans growing up. We knew if Georgia offered, there was going to be no second option. So as soon as they offered both of us, we were in there for sure.
So after college, did you go straight to Q school? Did you have to go Webb or whatever it was called at the time? Like, it's changed so many times now, but
yeah. So right out of college that summer, I did the Canadian tour. I did Q school there, got conditional status, and played I think 6 events up there and played terrible. But then that fall after was Q school, and you could only get to the Corn Ferry Tour at that time, so there was no PGA spots. But played well in Q school, got on Corn Ferry, and then in my second year got my card through the Corn Ferry Finals. Played well in Jacksonville to finish third there to get my tour card, and it's been a good ride ever since.
How did you celebrate the night you got your tour card?
My wife, who was my girlfriend at the time, my mom, brother, and dad went to a steakhouse down in, I think it was Roy's Steakhouse in Jacksonville Beach, maybe. And that was a pretty special night. That was really fun to kind of, it was a whirlwind because it was, you get your tour card, and then I think we had 1 week off, and then was Napa. So it was just kind of a quick change there.
Boys, I'll shut up in a second. I got one more question. Like, when once you get that card, are you like, now what the hell do I do?
It's kind of like you get the card and you're like, oh crap, now I got to compete against those guys. So you really just kind of have to just keep playing. If you're playing well going into it, you just got to try to take advantage. And at the time, the fall schedule, like I said, you had 1 week off. So it was good for me, I think, because I was playing well. So I could just kind of roll right into the PGA Tour and played some decent golf early to get into a reshuffle and ended up getting to play a lot of tournaments my rookie year, which was a huge benefit. Because if you don't get off to a good start your rookie year and you fall down in the reshuffle, it's really hard to keep your card because you're just fighting for spots in tournaments. And it's really kind of stacked against you at that point.
You're lucky now there's not, or when you started, there wasn't the like enhanced events or whatever they call it.
Yeah. The elevated events, no doubt. I mean,
like that right seems now, impossible for a rookie to stay on tour now.
Yeah. So the, top 125, is still what keeps your tour card. So 70 is playoffs. So it's not impossible, but you got to play some unbelievable golf to get into the playoffs as a rookie. And yeah, top 125 in December. So the fall schedule, you can still play those events to try to keep your card. So that's huge. But yeah, it definitely has gotten a lot harder because, all those elevated events, and then mixing in some regular open events with all the top guys are. So it's just, those fields are not going as deep as they used to. And like I said, it's even more important now to get off to a good start your rookie year, because if you don't, you're just not going to get a whole lot of starts.
I'm done now. Fine.
Okay, good. Turner, go ahead, big guy. I got a couple in my brain here, but go ahead if you want.
Okay. So when you were on the Corn Ferry, did you feel any pressure trying to get your tour card? And if you did you feel like, did you feel you had more pressure to get it or to keep it?
I would say the biggest pressure was to keep my Corn Ferry card. That was always kind of my big goal at the beginning of the year, because I was fairly young and I thought playing on the Corn Ferry was pretty cool. So my first year I got in fairly closely, but then my second year I played terrible until three tournaments left in the year. I was like 120 something on the money list and only 70 keep their card. So I had a lot of work to do, and fortunately played well in Kansas City and won that event. And that got me into the finals, and then finished third in Jacksonville. Finished third in Jacksonville and ended up getting my tour card that way. So honestly, I didn't even have time to think about getting my tour card because it all happened so quick. It was all within a 1 month span.
All right. So maybe not for you, but how hard is it going from meters to yards on the Euro Tour to the PGA Tour?
It's real easy for us because we just every week at the beginning we get a yardage book and we just tell them if we want meters or yards. So okay. the whole book is in whatever you want. It's other than that, it's just 10%. So that calculation used to, when I was living in Austria, every time I came over here, it was tough because I'd convert all my yardages every time I hit a shot. But now I'm just doing yards. So it's real easy for me now.
Okay. That would blow Drew's brain up if he had to do that.
Speaking of that, I mean, would you hire Torrey full-time to be your caddy?
I've got a great caddy on the bag.
He's got kids, his old caddy.
I got Dewey. He's unbeatable, really? That guy. So, unfortunately, no, Torrey.
That's great. No, I just wanted to throw a jab. He threw one at me. So, I want to know, let's go back to college. How many college wins and maybe your biggest event yet, pro or amateur or
collegiate? Zero college wins. Never won in college. I was decent in college. So my first year, I was pretty decent for a young guy, and I played in some tournaments, never got in the postseason. But then my third year, I developed a case of the chipping yips and had to redshirt because I didn't qualify for a tournament. And so that took it out of me for about a year, year and a half. Did not even compete in tournaments. I was just trying to make bogeys when I missed the green. So that was tough. But then started working my way out of that. And then my fifth year, my senior year, I really played some pretty good golf. And I didn't win any tournaments, but I contended in a few, and just kind of really felt like my game was starting to come together a little bit.
Okay, so if tomorrow morning, full swing, season three, Sepp, we want you on the show. Would you do it or no?
No, definitely not. No, nothing against full swing, but I try to be a little kind of low key.
Yeah,
don't really seek out the cameras or anything. So definitely would. And I can't imagine having cameras follow me around all year, coming to my house to film.
All year, hey?
Yeah, it's well, I don't know about all. Well, they definitely do all year at tournaments. They're always getting footage from you, and but then they do like an in-depth thing where they come to your house as well. And I would pass.
Fair enough,
dude. Sepp's the most low-key guy ever. Like, if you ran into him at Piggly Wiggly down the street, you'd never know it was a guy playing in the Tour Championship. Speaking of Tour Championship, so kind of piggybacking off of Rip's question earlier, like, what point when you were on tour were you like, I can whip these guys' ass? Like, where you felt like you belonged and you could compete, if that makes sense.
That's a good question. I mean, I feel like that varies so much, because there was times when I was playing some really good golf my first, second year out, where I felt like I could really compete in any tournament. But then there was times, you know, this year, this past year, where I felt like I could not compete at all, where I just my game wasn't in a good place. So I feel like it just varies so much. But when I have my game, I feel like I can definitely compete with anybody. I've been trying to last like 3 or 4 years to make it a lot more consistent, where I can have my game a little more often than I used to. And I feel like that's kind of translated into a little more success on the golf course the last few years.
Gotcha.
Like it. Ripper?
Go ahead, coach.
Okay, well, I want to talk low score. So lowest score pro event and lowest score amateur event, or just dicking around with the boys?
Pro event 62 Sunday at John Deere. Doubled the last, but still got the win. So I guess bittersweet. I had a chance to
62
shoot
with the double?
Double at the last, yeah.
Oh.
That was tough. Had a chance to shoot 59 and ended up doubling the last, but still got the win. So that's nice. And then just playing with the boys, I shot 61 a bunch at Greystone. I don't even think I've ever shot 60.
Which side?
Founders.
Okay.
Yeah, Founders is the one where I shot 61. I don't think I shot 61 at Legacy. I think 62 is my low there. And at Shoal, it's, I don't know, 68 or something. I've never played well at Shoal. You got to hit a fade off every tee box.
Okay, so I want to ask this now, because I just saw an interview the other day. I'm sure you saw it with Scotty Scheffler talking about his handicap with his buddies. What would you play to with your buddies, or if they said, hey, we need X amount of shots, what's your cap these days?
So there's a good group of pros in Birmingham, so I'm fortunate I don't really have to give out shots out there. There's only one guy, Jeff Curl. He's the only one I ever give a shot out to. He gets two in the front and adjusts the back. So he's the only one. But other
is
than him,
he still a gambling maniac?
Say that again.
Try again.
Pardon? One more time, Tori. Cut out, big guy.
So is he still a gambling maniac?
Yeah, he loves a good wolf game, or that's what we play every time is wolf. But yeah, he just loves the action. He loves the game with the guys at home, and he kind of built the whole Birmingham golf scene.
God, now my internet's.
So Sepp's basically saying that he plays at a plus two.
Gotcha. Okay,
fair enough. So he gives me a shot. Perfect. We're laughing then.
Well, Curl's pretty good, I'll say that, especially at Greystone. So I don't think he needs those shots at that course. But
so, like, if you had to say today, like, what would you say, like, you shoot on average? Like, what was your scoring average this year?
I mean, at home it's a lot better than on the PGA Tour. I'd say at home it's probably around, if I had to guess, 68-ish, 67, somewhere in there. 68 probably at Greystone. It kind of depends on the golf course too. Like at Shoal, that would never be that because that course does not suit my game very well. But Greystone, yeah, I'd say it's probably about 68-ish.
Nice work.
All right, so one thing I definitely wanted to, and I think I told you when I was caddying for you, like I didn't want to ask questions because I wanted to wait for this. But talk to me about the Ryder Cup.
Ryder Cup,
like how awesome. Fucking how dope was that? Just knowing you were on the team first of all, and then how that first tee shot.
Yeah, Ryder Cup was unbelievable. It was an experience I'll never forget. Rome was incredible. The fans were awesome. First tee shot was probably the most nervous I've ever been by a mile. I was playing Thursday or Friday morning was the first round. I played with Shane in an alternate shot, and he was just so pumped when Luke told him that I'd be getting the odd numbers because that meant that I had to hit the opening tee shot. And yeah, it lived up to the hype. I mean, I couldn't feel my arms, couldn't feel my legs. I snap hooked it left in the hay, and Shane came up to me and said, "Well, thank God that's over with. Now we can go play some golf." And yeah, that was a special day. It was a fun day. We ended up playing some good golf that day too, and got the win.
Is that the same Ryder Cup with what's his nuts? Take your hat off. Same one.
Yeah, same one. Yeah.
Okay, sweet. So yeah. That's been unreal environment then.
That was incredible. Yeah, it was awesome. I mean, it was crazy from the first day on all the way through Sunday, and it was a lot of fun.
Like, do you boys? I mean, I don't know what you can and can't say, but do you guys get after though? Like after the rounds, like you're having a time, or is it kind of like quiet hours?
Not during the tournament. Sunday night was a lot of fun, but no tournament nights. Even Tyrrell was on the zeros, so yeah, we had. We had fun, but Sunday night was the big fun.
That's probably cool. You got to be so exhausted after that, like 36-36, like, and there's no daylight. Like, that's got to be tiring.
Yeah, it's I mean, it's all day, every day, and just so, like, just emotionally draining. You know, it's just every single shot means so much. You got so many fans riding with you on every single shot, and it's just, I mean, it's an incredible amount of fun, but it is definitely draining. I mean, by the end of the day, every night, you're just exhausted going to bed. But then you can't wait to get up and do it again the next day.
Didn't you guys drum them on day one at the Americans?
Yes. Yeah. We got off to a huge lead day one. Oh. We won the first 4 points in the morning session, and then I think three of the four in the afternoon session.
So I don't know how to put it. After you put a beat down on day one, like, are you guys buddies with them obviously on the tour? I'm sure you say hi to them, but like during that week or so, like friends off, eh? Like kind of like just at a game and like of hockey, for example.
No, so it's we don't see them at all off the golf course. So they have their own dining, their own locker room. They're on their own side of the hotel, and we kind of go separate ways. So we really don't see them other than while we're inside the ropes playing the match. So it's a very different environment than I would say a regular PGA Tour event is.
So, okay, last question for me about the Ryder Cup. How weird is it that you've lived more than half of your life in the U.S., but playing for Europe? Like, is that strange? Because it would, like, I've always grown up cheering for U.S. in the Ryder Cup, and now I live here, but I grew up in Canada just because I was a Fred Couples fan growing up. So like, how weird is it you've spent, again, most of your life in the U.S. but you're playing for Europe? Like, is that a weird dynamic, or are you just like straight up, let's go to Austria?
It's not that weird. You know, my whole golf career has always been for Austria. So obviously learned the game over there. I played on the Austrian junior golf team. So even when I was living here in the States, I would go over there and play in the European boys team championship and the European men's amateur team championship and all that for Austria. And I played the Olympics for Austria. So I've always kind of felt it, you know, Austria's kind of where my golf game is, I guess. And I'm very proud to represent Austria because obviously it's not a huge golf country, but there's a good golf community, and yeah, they kind of rallied behind it. It's incredible.
I completely forgot that you played the Olympics. Tell us about that.
It was great. So my first one was Tokyo, no fans. So that was a bit of a bummer, but it was awesome too. But then this time in Paris was just incredible. So many fans. The golf course was great. The event was great. And yeah, it was a pretty special week being over there and trying to get a medal.
So I have a question. Sorry, Tori, I'm cutting you off. So in Austria, for example, you go to the Olympics in Paris. Are you like talking to like, I don't know what they call them, but the governor or the president of Austria and saying, hey, like if you make top three, you get a medal, like you get some dough, some kickback, or like, how does that work for you?
No, there's no, you don't really talk to the, no, he's just kind of, so there's the head of the Austrian Golf Federation kind of helps you set everything up with where you're staying and all the logistics of things. And yeah, that's really the only interaction you have. And then he's there kind of guiding you around and anything you need, he's there to help out. But yeah, not with the president or anything like that.
What's his handle? Is he a president or a governor?
So we've got a president and a chancellor. So, but the president is a little bit more of a figurehead. But all the athletes do, I missed it because I was playing a tournament, but all the athletes do meet with the president before they go off to the Olympics. And cool. Yeah, they have kind of meet and greet and then where you get your clothes and all that stuff. So that's pretty special. But unfortunately, I missed that. I was at the Open.
No, speaking of logistics, my question was going to be like, how brutal was it trying to get to the course? Because I would imagine traffic is hell.
So, yes, but we actually did not stay in the village. We stayed in a hotel 10 minutes from the course. So it was really easy for us. For those staying in the village, it was about a 45-hour endeavor trying to get to the course every day. But there was most of the people, I would say, stayed in hotels out closer to the course.
Doesn't sound perfect.
Rollo Golf, presenting sponsor of the Off the Hustle podcast. Reminder, at checkout, on all orders, Hosel 25, HOSEL 25, promo code for 25% off on all orders. Check out Rollo Golf today.
Perfect. Boys, do we want to head to the back nine, or we got more questions?
I just want to see Rip has some saliva, so he wants to chat away here. Rip, go right ahead, bud.
So during the Ryder Cup, Rory got in that little scrum with the caddy. You got any funny stories or anything about that there?
Not really. It was, you know, it's kind of all on camera, the whole thing. It was kind of a crazy moment. I remember standing next to the green and I had no idea what was going on. It was, all of a sudden everybody started shouting and then I look over and Rory and, LeCava are kind of face to face, just staring each other down. And I had no idea what was even happening. So, yeah, it was kind of crazy. And then definitely tempers were pretty high afterwards in the locker room, I think from both sides. And yeah, that was definitely made it a lot of fun.
So did you feel like there's another level of intensity like the day after that happened?
I would think so, yeah. Definitely kind of focused our minds a little bit. They had a lot of momentum going into that night, I guess, because Patrick did hold that huge putt. Yeah, we just kind of, I think maybe it just even focused us a little bit to kind of, you know, make sure we bring our best the next day and don't just, cause we definitely had a pretty big lead. We could have easily kind of overlooked it a little bit, but yeah, definitely focused our minds a little bit to try to finish the job.
Imagine running the his name's Shane Lowry, right? The big guy.
Yeah.
Imagine running to that guy in the parking lot. Yeesh.
Yeah, I don't. Shane, after a few Guinnesses, I don't think I want to see that.
Okay, I want to ask. Well, yeah, we're the back nine, obviously presented by and sponsored by the Tower Tap House 1124 here in Estevan, Saskatchewan. I'm gonna jump right into it. A day in the life for you as a PGA Tour player. You know what? Maybe we'll talk about maybe an off day and the day of opening day, opening round, day one.
Yeah, off day. So I guess there's two kind of different kinds of off days. One's just where you're just trying to rest and recover, where you don't play golf, just do anything else. it's hard for me to stay away, really. I love playing. So, and then like just a regular practice day at home, you just, it's definitely a little less intense than it is on the road. You go do your warm up in the gym, maybe get a workout in, and then do the practice session. Usually my practice sessions are 3 to 3.5 hours, somewhere in there, between putting, hitting on TrackMan, doing all my drills, in the gym. So, and then if you have time after that, just, go join the Wolf game at Greystone and, try to have some fun with the guys while also, playing some golf. And I'd say that's kind of a normal practice day at home if I'm doing a practice day.
So how many balls would you be hitting on the range? Like, are you doing like a wedge session and then like quick lunch, and then are you just doing a full bag day, like full in that 3 hours?
Yeah. So normal range session is, I do all my drills, which is probably about 30 or 40 balls. Just different drills that my coach has me do to kind of work on my tendencies. And then I get into TrackMan. I do a wedge combine, which is 30 shots from 50 to 130 yards. And then irons, I do a strokes gain game, which is basically kind of a test on TrackMan where they kind of give you a different pin with a different green layout and a different yardage on every shot. And that's 30 random shots as well. And then probably 5 to 10 drivers somewhere in there after that. So yeah, overall, I mean, it's not crazy amount, but it's a purposeful practice that I started doing about 2 years ago, a year and a half ago, where used to, I hated hitting balls on the range. I just hated it. I would go hit 10 balls. I'm like, well, I'm hitting it pretty good. I don't really know what else to do. I don't, it was kind of goalless, I guess. And this kind of practice regimen has really helped me have more purpose in my preparation, in my practice.
I like that, the sounds of that, way better than just beating 500 balls.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that's what I used to do. If I wasn't hitting it good, I'd just go try to figure it out. And that's maybe stand out there for 2 hours just hitting balls, trying to figure out where it's going. And that was definitely not, I don't think that was the way to go. I think kind of every day doing my drills in the gym and on the range to kind of help my tendencies. And then after that, just shut off the technique and try to hit golf shots on the range. And that's been huge for me the last few years.
Yeah, that sounds far more productive. Rip, fire away, buddy.
So who is your coach and how often do you see him then?
John Tillery. He's at Lake Oconee in Georgia. But I see him. He comes on the road a decent amount. He comes, I don't know, 10, 12 events a year. And then I go see him probably 3 or 4 times a year at his place where we can do a little more, dive into a little more deeper swing stuff. On the road, we usually don't do too much. It's kind of a checkup. And if I need any kind of pointers, just small things that we can change to help ball striking that week. But we go into kind of deeper swing stuff when I go to his place and come up with the plan for the next few months to kind of work on those tendencies.
What's that course at Lake Oconee?
It's Cuscoilla.
Cuscoilla. What's your low round there?
I just go hit balls on the range there. I haven't played since college, I don't think. We used to qualify there some, but I honestly don't even remember my lowest score there. I've only played there probably 5 times.
Okay. I like in our little back nine, quick nine, I like to ask random questions. Favorite Christmas song?
Ooh. Probably I'm Dreaming of a White Christmas. I always like that one. I don't even know if that's the name of it, but.
Solid choice. No, yeah. We know what you're talking about.
Okay. I want to ask, so golf tournament travelers, for example, your Friday shoot 69, are you going to the range after? Are you snapping a cold one in the lounge? Like, I was wondering, they always say, oh, this guy's going to the range to practice and work on a few things. Like, do you ever want to just get off the course and just relax?
Yeah, so I don't do a whole lot of practice after the rounds. I try to do, so I maybe start my routine a little bit earlier than some guys, and I do those drills in the gym, do those drills on the range before I go play. But after I'm done, I go see my physio for about 30 minutes, and then then it's back to the house or the hotel, wherever I'm staying for me. So yeah, I don't like going to hit balls after. I feel like usually that's when I end up just searching for something.
Right.
Yeah, I just kind of like doing those things in the morning before the rounds, and that's kind of helped me a little bit.
You know what I noticed in that full swing, and maybe you can correct me if I'm wrong, but like they bring those carts on the, like those traveling, the massive cases or carts, you want to call them, and they have like gyms in them. Is that correct?
Yeah, so we've got a workout trailer that travels with the tour. Yeah. It's awesome. It's great. I mean, it's anything we need. It's pretty spacious too. And then there's a therapy trailer as well, where they've got physios and stuff like that in there. And then now they have a recovery tent with ice baths. And so it's come a long way really since I got out here, where it's very focused on recovery and preparation in the gym.
That's cool. Go ahead, boys. I have a few more after this.
So you mentioned you're going to Wentworth here soon. I went to the event last year, and I lived in the area for the last 3 years. And like, how is that course? Because everyone that's from that area always talks about wanting to play there, and like, it's the best course around, but it's just so tough to get on. So
yeah, it's awesome. I mean, it's all it's cracked up to be. That last year's the first year I played it, and it might be my favorite event that's not a major championship. It's way up there for me. The golf course is awesome. The event's great. You know, the crowds are incredible. And it's a special place. And yeah, anybody whoever has a chance to go play either the tournament or just the course itself, I'd highly recommend it.
Yeah, just walking in, I'm like, this place is sick.
It's sick. It's awesome. It's so cool. And it's not. That's the first time I played parkland golf in England. I've only ever played links over there, and yeah, it's a special place. It's not what I'd pictured before I went, and it's yeah, it's awesome. So I'll definitely, that'll be on my schedule for a long time to come.
All right, another random one. What have you been watching lately, TVs or movies?
TV. Been watching The Bear. My wife and I have been watching this show called The Bear on Hulu, about a guy who's trying to run a restaurant. Pretty stressful, it seems. Makes golf seem like a walk in the park. But yeah, it's pretty good. A little funny, a little drama. Other than that, that's pretty much where we've been the last month or so.
How do you watch movies when you're flying?
Oh my gosh.
I do, yeah. Sorry, my thing keeps cutting off. But yeah, I actually watched one that kind of escaped me on the flight home from Paris. I watched Bridge of Spies, I think is what it's called, with Tom Hanks. Great movie. I think 2015 or so. I don't know how I never watched it, but yeah, it was awesome.
Okay. How often are you changing clubs? I know they bring those carts on the road or trailers on the road for, you know, clubs if you need them. Are you changing wedges, lots, you know, your drivers, your irons? I mean, what's kind of your status quo kind of thing?
Generally, I don't change much. Wedges, I go through a lot. I go through a 60 about every month and a half or so, maybe 2 months. And then the other wedges, I change every 3 or so months, 3 or 4 months. Just because that metal's a little softer, I use them a lot more in practice. And so they get worn out a little more, and it's pretty important to have that 60 nice and fresh, because you can just get so much more spin on it around the greens. Yeah, irons probably every year, I would say, same with the driver and woods, every year, maybe year and a half. So I don't like it. Once I have something that I like, I don't like switching out of it.
What about if you get free irons every year? Would you, in, let's just say the same ones are coming the next year, would you change irons again?
If you know, I try to, it takes me a while to get into a new set, like a completely different iron, but Strixon is bringing out new irons at the end of the year, and I'm going to give them a try. We'll see how they are. I'm sure they're going to be great. Strixon's made great irons for a long time now. It's been pretty easy to switch in and out of those, but yeah, I'm usually a little stubborn when it comes to changing equipment.
So what about the same irons you had all year, and then you get new irons, but the same exact iron, same spec, same grip? Would you keep the ones you've already used or get the same ones again?
But so usually after a year, I switch to a new set. Yeah, exactly the same specs, same iron. But yeah, I usually switch into a new one after about a year.
Fair enough.
So when you're on lots, does your wife come with you lots? Like, do you have a pretty big crew that follows you around, or are you on your own?
My wife and son come to most of the tournaments now. He's 8 months, so early on he didn't travel a lot, but yeah, they come to most tournaments now, and it's usually just them, unless my parents are coming to a tournament. Like, they came to Atlanta, my mom came to Atlanta, brother came to Atlanta because it was close, but yeah, usually it's just them, and then my coaches will travel separately, my caddy will travel separately, and I just meet them there when I get there.
All right, my last random hitter. What's on your perfect pizza?
I love a – ooh, that's a good question.
Thank you.
You don't have to lie, Sepp. That's not a good question. You don't have to lie to him. You don't have to tell him how good he is. Brutal.
I like a supreme, but no mushrooms. So sausage, pepperoni, onions, peppers, but not the mushrooms. You can keep those.
No peppers on there. What are you talking about? Peppers on there? Yeah, the meat.
What are you talking about? Bad question. He's used to. Everyone asks him, "Hey, what was it like the first time you played on tour?" I want to know real people shit.
Well, I'm gonna ask two questions here. One's gonna be a good question, and two, I want to ask where that hat's from because I want one of them. Number one is mental coach. Do you have one? Do you use one? Have you got rid of it? I mean, I'm honestly curious to see if you have one, and because I mean, I know that they're a big part of today's world.
I don't have one. I have talked to mental coaches before. I've read a lot of books about the mental side, but I don't have a guy that I talk to on a regular basis. I kind of divide that out to caddy coaches, wife. Unfortunately, she has to deal with a lot of it. brother. So yeah, it kind of gets spread around a little bit, but yeah, I don't have anybody that I regularly talk to, but I have talked to mental coaches, in the past, especially when I was on Korn Ferry tour a little bit, just trying to learn more about it. And
right.
Yeah. I read a lot of books about it. So yeah, it's definitely a very important part of it, especially in golf. Just it's a mental grind a lot of times. So, anytime you can kind of help that side of it, it's huge.
Corey's my mental coach when I talk to him about golf, so he's done wonders for me. Sepp, the hat.
Got you to Nationals.
Looked sick. You did get me to Nationals. Thanks for that, by the way. where's the hat from?
Hat's the from the UGA TF Club. It's Georgia Bulldog leaning out on a Georgia golf bag. You can get it on the UGA TF Club website. It's kind of the booster club for the Georgia golf team, and they do an awesome job. So. And the logo is awesome too. That's the most important part.
Way better like than it.
Hopefully the football team can win 9 games this year.
I think they'll win more than that.
They'll probably win 19.
I got a good feeling about it.
I don't hate them.
Rip, you got any more?
So you mentioned your caddy. Like, what? Like, how'd you meet him? What does he do for you? Like, what do you cover? I'm asking this because I caddied a couple weeks back, first pro event, and my guy won. So
nice.
Yeah, I know it's not like that every week, but I was like, this is pretty cool. Like, I wouldn't mind getting into this.
Yeah, well, ironically, the first time he worked for me, we won John Deere. So yeah, it's a good start. But I've known Dewey for a while now. He was on Kevin Kisner's bag before. And so that's how I got to know him was through Kiz. And yeah, Dewey's an awesome guy. He's really good at his job. He does a great job, bringing the same energy no matter what, whether I'm playing well, bad, just always kind of in the moment. And yeah, he's awesome to have on the bag. And what else did you ask?
What? I don't want to say how much you pay him, but like, what do you cover? Like, how do you take care of him? How does he take care of you?
Yeah. So he's got a weekly amount that I pay him basically I guess it kind of helped cover his expenses, and then it's a percentage base after that. So if we make the cut, depending on how I play or how we do together, he gets a percentage of that cut, and then a win is 10%, obviously. No, he's great. He he's there from whenever I need him. He's hard worker. Courses that he hasn't seen, it's fun to see him work those because he's always running around from sprinkler to sprinkler, getting numbers, getting cover numbers to certain parts of the green, and then he's got all those in his book by the first round. So it's an awesome job that he does, and he's been great for my career for sure the last just over a year now, year and a half.
Okay, I got one quick last one. And I don't want to burn you here. Who are you rooting for in the President's Cup?
US for sure.
Oh,
But
shit.
I wanted to be competitive though. I'd like to see a good, because I mean, I love Mike Weir. He's a good guy. The international side's got so many awesome guys on the team. So they're easy to root for, and I just love to see a good event.
Fair. I'm done, boys.
Yeah. Well, what I wanted to say was, Sepp, appreciate coming to the podcast today, man. It was, 159. We get a guy that just played in the Tour Championship. Unbelievable interview today. Reminder, this podcast presented by Roll of Golf. Hosel 25 at checkout, 25% off on all orders. Do it today. Tori's wearing the nice splatter Q-zip and the F-bomb
And
hat.
the F-bomb hat.
Yeah, I was going, Tori. And I'm wearing the Hawaiian Rolo golf shirt. Check out Rolo today. Sepp, man, we appreciate this you coming on. I mean, we feel pretty special having a guy that was just at the Tour Championship and being one of the top 30 players in the world. Hope we can do it again, and maybe before the season gets going again here. So thanks again.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me, guys. Appreciate it.
Well, we hope you enjoyed the episode. Quick reminder and thank you to our sponsors, presenting sponsor Roll of Golf at checkout, Hosel 25 on all orders purchased. That's HOSEL 25 at Roll of Golf. Thanks to TaylorMade Golf. The Tower Tap House 1124 in Estevan, Saskatchewan, and our pre-show sponsor, Remax and Jeff Will. We'll talk to you all next week.